So I'd like to begin with this self-written poem. It's called Sit Like a Lady. It details the lessons that I've learned growing up as a girl. At 4, I learned biology, when little boys refused to play with the girl. Evidently, what's between your legs is more important than what's between your shoulders. At 6, I learned grammar, from constantly identifying as a question mark. Because where do you go when you're not girly enough for the girls and too much so for the boys? At 8, I learned vocabulary from a dictionary containing words that are only whispered and never said aloud. For only boys for friends spells trouble, and in a country so poor, the only thing that comes free to all is judgment. At 10, I learned physics, all about how light hits mirrors and reflects only our insecurities, how sound echoes in mysterious ways, such that we only hear taunts on repeat in our head. At 12, I learned speaking, or the lack thereof, unable to speak up against what made me uncomfortable and how to never forgive myself for it. At 14, I learned geometry, what is hot in measurement and numbers, and went from too fat to too thin, never quite right to fit in. At 16, I learned art, or that which is aesthetically appealing, and found myself finally hitting the mark, only to find that the mark had actually been placed on me. I learned that that which I had neither earned nor deserved would come to mark me more than what I had acquired. That wit, charm, and intellect couldn't hold up a candle to what the eye could behold. I learned that my body does not always mean my choice. And no matter what my choice, it was always wrong. But now I am 18, and what have I learned? I've learned that I could never learn enough, that I should always want to know more, see more, and be more than what I'm told to be. That pretty is not the price that I pay for existing in this world, but that I can take it as a compliment without bile rising up my throat. So today, I own up to me, bold, brave, brilliant, beautiful if I so desire, but most importantly, aware of my own fire. It's not what I have endured, but what I want to endure still. For with the voice comes a choice to use it simply as my own, or to speak up for those for whom such freedom is unknown. So today I claim red, fiery, passionate, defiant, bold, the color of sindoor, the color of blood, spilt through the ages to be spilt no more. Together we'll rise, can you see the furrow? Today we're crossing boundaries, we're no longer crossing our legs. I'm sorry, darling, there's no longer a second sex. This poem, it basically captures my struggles in coming to terms with my identity as a woman and a feminist and why I'm standing here today. What is it that at 18 years of age drives me to try and make feminists of you all, to try and bring change to a world that's perfectly comfortable with the status quo? Stories, my story and those of people that I know, stories that I've read and heard, stories that I hope to uncover as a journalist someday. When I talk about my own story, I do so with complete cognizance of my own privilege that allows me to stand here and speak like this today. I was always a strong believer in equality, even before I knew of the existence of terms such as feminism. For me, it all started on the playing field with an ardent desire to play football, and a bunch of boys who, even in their nascent stages of life, found this to be an unacceptable activity for a girl. Not to be brought down so easily, I stubbornly turned up at the playing field each day to be beaten, bullied, and pushed around. I learned to staunch my cuts and scrapes and soothe my bruised self-esteem, while the boys learned gradually to tolerate, if not accept me. But even as they did so, they reminded me constantly that I was an oddity, a misfit, and lacking in skill compared to the far superior boys. Even as I improved over the years, going on to play in tournaments for my school, the boys simply couldn't accept that I possessed any talent, which in no manner took away from theirs, constantly engaging in this battle to be on top. My love for football, my knowledge, my passion for my club was constantly questioned by those who possessed neither. And at an age where girls and boys don't even sit together, my absurd activities ensured that I made barely any bonds with the girls, because I wasn't girly enough. Evidently, the hallmarks of womanhood were glitter pens and nail paints and slam books, none of which I had any interest in. And I also found that these activities led to no dearth of judgment from elders, who had nothing to do with my life, but everything to do with my reputation. As I grew up, I had Harry Potter-style round-rim specs, a chubby frame, and a boy cut. So you could be sure that the harassment didn't end on the field. And I can't count the number of times that I've been chided for being too loud or too opinionated or just too much. Too much more than the little space allotted to me as a woman in this world. A tiny space that barely allows me to breathe or exist or even view the world from behind the bars. A lot of people thought that I wanted to be a boy, as if dressing or sports or general demeanor is what makes me a woman, not biology. But I found that puberty and paradox went hand in hand, because I hit what is considered the beauty jackpot in India. You just have to be tall, thin, and fair. So I went to the opposite end of the spectrum of being judged for my looks. From being too nerdy and unattractive, I came to be viewed solely on the basis of my appearance. I also discovered the dark side of this so-called boon in terms of unwanted sexual advances. Nearly 1 in 10 women worldwide experience some form of forced sexual acts at least once in their lifetime. Nearly 80 to 85% of these are perpetrated by somebody that they know. In my own case, I found that these were boys I had known and trusted for most of my life, and in the most incongruous of environments like classrooms and lifts and parks. On 2 occasions, I spoke out to stop this, only to receive a barrage of violence and abuse and anger in return, leaving me crippled with fear when this happened again. Worse than the actual incidents was the self-loathing that came afterwards, because I blamed myself for not being able to speak up against something that made me uncomfortable. I felt like I was going against the views that I hold so strongly. And I felt that my fear was without basis. But then I came across these images in my news feed a couple of weeks ago. I'm just going to read out the captions real quick. Photos aren't flattering, I know. Last night I didn't give a man my number, so he pushed me over. This is the result. A 22-year-old was shot in the face after telling a man to stop grinding on her. Woman slashed in the neck after ignoring a man. Woman killed after saying no to proposal. A husband chopped off his wife's hands after saying she failed to have children. A former cop beats his girlfriend to death for not submitting. After I saw these images, I realized that while it isn't okay for me to be silent, my fear isn't without basis. There are some men driven by a sense of entitlement and an utter inability to understand women's right to their own choices. In my own experience, I've found that boys that I've turned down have taken to hurling abuses, questioning my sexuality, asking me, following me, pestering me constantly with calls. Gone from harassment of one kind to another, my self-esteem mostly in shambles. That's why today I don't grow out my nails. Because during this period, I developed this habit of digging them in too deep into my palms to distract myself. I developed this habit of scratching myself because pain on the outside distracts you from what's going on inside. And I've been suicidal at more than one point in my life. But the reason I'm standing here today is not just for the people I love, but also because I found a higher purpose in bringing about a change that I want to see. So slowly but surely, I've learned to start forgiving myself, because even though I haven't always known how to speak up in the past, I do know how to do so now. So when all of this happened as a consequence, I started rejecting all stereotypical notions of femininity. I refused to grow out my hair or apply kajal or lipstick. I used to dress in typically boyish clothes. I hated being called pretty. I myself used to judge other women who used to like dressing up. I styled myself as the polar opposite. But today I've come to realize that that's equally harmful. Because when we as women tear each other down, how can we look to others to build us up? Most girls, they grow up wanting to be the princess in fairy tales. I grew up wanting to be the fire-breathing dragon. But today, I've realized that there is no dichotomy between these two. Every princess has a fire-breathing dragon within her. And that's why, when I stand here today, I don't offer you a concrete definition of what feminism should mean to you or what it should mean to me. All I think it's about is equality and choice. A choice for all of us, irrespective of our gender, Our choices to burn our bras or wear them, our choices to wax or shave or not to, choices of books and clothes and movies and how we express ourselves. So today, even though I'm still more comfortable in a pair of studs than I'll ever be in heels, I can't apply winged eyeliner to save my life. I still enjoy dressing up on occasion, and today I managed to make a straight line of kajal in only half an hour, and I'm quite proud of that. I've discovered that we can be beautiful and smart, confident and introverted, strong yet soft, everything at once. I know that a lot of people object to the word feminism for a movement for equality, but I don't see a contentious issue there when the entire history of the human race's effort towards mankind. Any movement to equalize opportunity will naturally give preference to those who've been historically disadvantaged. But that doesn't mean that men don't suffer under the burden of the patriarchal paradigm. I've seen so many boys that I know who suffer so much, but they never talk about it because men are expected to be stoic and strong. I've seen them keep their emotions in till they come out in the worst of ways, in violence and anger and shouting. I've seen so seemingly well-brought-up, well-educated men reveal their true colors when an incident hits too close to home. They control their girlfriends, censure their sisters, ask women they know to dress appropriately. Especially on the playing field, I've seen how badly boys are bullied and beaten up for depicting any kind of so-called softness or what they consider girlish behavior. Ridiculed and name-called, taunted, they're called gay or girly, as if these things were insults by themselves. I've seen them break down and cry, but then repeat the same behavior a few years later. Seen how vicious patterns are emulated across generations, passed on from child to child. One of the worst cases of bullying I ever faced was by this boy who came from an abusive household. He saw his father curse and hit his mother every night, and he tried to emulate the same pattern with me. His mother was a crying, sobbing mess, who apologized to me profusely over and over again, as if that was something she was used to doing. And that's why I think we need feminism, so that all of us, him and I both, have a shot at being who we want to be, not what we're forced to turn into. In India, rape and sexual assault laws are women-specific. Section 354 of the Indian Penal Code, which pertains to assault, refers to an intent to outrage a woman's modesty. A statement that in itself is inherently problematic, but which also implies that men, transgenders, and those who don't conform to the gender binary are left without legal recourse. Men are stalked, raped, assaulted, and harassed, but there's a stunning lack of understanding about the same, and there's an absence of discussion about this in mainstream media. So if you'll ask me again why I choose to do this, why I choose to stay up nights reading articles, marking out things that I want to change, why I chose to write this talk to and fro, standing in the metro on my way from college every day, why I'm choosing a life now as a journalist and a feminist advocate, I'll tell you the same thing. Stories. Of my friend whose cut lips I held bandaged because her father hit her with a belt every night. Of my friend whose father used to drag her specially to make her watch him beat up her mother. Of my maids who've turned up with cut faces and sore eyes one time too many. For all my friends who've been slut-shamed. For all my friends who are boys and can't express their feelings because they have this burden of being strong. For my friend who's a transgender, transitioning to being this beautiful woman. For the sex workers at GB Road who talk about how even the police refuses to help them because their profession makes them less than a human in society's eyes. For the girls I work with at Hunar Foundation whose parents hesitate to send them to school. That's just 2 minutes away from their house. For women who live in Parda in a village that is just 15 minutes away from this very spot. For all the women who, unlike me, haven't had the chance of being born, being educated, or standing here speaking as freely as I do so today. We often forget that the fight isn't just about us. We're not bothered till incidents start affecting us directly. But as a millennial woman today, I'm not just fighting for body positivity or the right to wear what I want. I'm also fighting for menstrual hygiene, against domestic violence, against marital rape, and all of these things. Because we need to stop viewing people through the prism of the function they occupy in someone else's life. They don't need to be someone's mother, daughter, brother, or sister, man, woman, or transgender. This entire men's versus women's rights debate too takes away from the mettle of this movement. Why? Because we have to remember that all we're fighting for is the fundamental worth of a human life. We're not just a collection of atoms and molecules, whether an X chromosome combined with a Y chromosome, more than what societal constructs demand of us to be. We think that revolutions are people spilling out onto streets, shouting and waving flags, but we forget that they start here, with you and me. So that's all I ask of you today. All I ask is for you to ask away. Question everything. I read somewhere once that the first thought that crosses your head is the one that you've been conditioned to believe. And the one that comes afterwards is the person that you're trying to be. So the next time you cross a woman and you judge her for her clothes, ask yourself if you truly believe it to be a reflection of her character. Ask yourself why we're okay with our heroes talking women on screen, why we sing along to item numbers, why we laugh at sexist jokes. Why are we okay with the advertisements depicting women in stereotypical housemaker roles? And why is this important? Because the same society that lets a man get away with a sexist comment makes him think that he can get away with worse. It makes the woman standing there believe that nobody will support her if she speaks up. It reinforces the patriarchy in our lives every day. So all I ask of you is to question the norms. Just because something's continued for a very long time doesn't make it right. Sati was a norm once, as was apartheid. What we're fighting today is the systematic subjugation of almost half the human race. And it's a long and hard fight, but the drill remains the same as it was when I was 8 years old on the football field. No matter how many times you get pushed down, you get back up, you dust yourself off, you wipe what's bleeding, and you get back in the game. Sometimes it's your knees that are bleeding, and sometimes it's your heart. And it may be a 90-minute match, or it may be the rest of your life, but giving up has never been an option. So all I ask of you is to question and to fight in whatever way you can. But first of all, question why, if at all, you're scared to call yourself a feminist. I didn't begin this talk with a good morning, because I don't think it's a good morning, or a good day, or a good era. I don't think it's been a good time at all. And I'm not idealistic enough to believe that the world's just going to get better. But I hope I'm realistic enough in believing that together we can make it better. I'm not going to end this with a thank you, because I don't have anything to thank you for yet. But I hope I will soon when you go out and change the world, one question at a time.